Days to weeks. That's how long it could take to free the container ship currently blocking the Suez Canal. That's according to the Dutch salvage company tasked with the mission to move it. John Defterios joins us now. John, we talked yesterday about just how important this is as a trade route, but if we're talking about it being blocked for days to weeks, I mean, that's going to create huge issues. What are the options here for trying to move the vessel?
Well, it's amazing. Since our discussion yesterday, Julia, we're 2 days into this effort, and we have a much clearer idea what's taking place within the canal. And the three options are pretty clear. It's tugging, dredging, and unloading. And none of them seems to be unfolding very quickly at this stage, particularly if you have to unload. We now know because of that, the Suez Canal Authority has suspended all traffic going into this major artery that handles 30% of all seaborne traffic. Not too surprising, but it did also announce there's two major salvage companies being hired in, the big guns, if you will. One of the CEOs of the two companies, Boskalis, was suggesting that if you have to unload the vessel, it could take weeks. If we could really dredge, it would take a matter of days. This is sending shivers throughout the trading community, of course. The two companies are Smit, a partner with Boskalis, and Nippon Salvage, because the vessel's owner is indeed Japanese. Now, the current technical manager that's been doing the operation so far, BSM, said they tried to dredge along with tugging, but they're not having a great deal of influence so far. And in fact, if you look at some of the photos that are out there, you see this digger underneath the Ever Given, the vessel that's stranded, and it seems completely dwarfed. And in fact, on Dutch TV, when the CEO of Boskalis was asked, what do you think of this? And this is a great quote. He says, that ship is very much in the way. It's got to be moved, Julia, but not in the current operations or the current state of play in terms of how they're trying to solve it.
I'm sort of smiling, but it's not funny at all. But very much in the way is most definitely understating the problem here. Diverting the vessels.
Yeah, it's a very Dutch sense of humor.
I was about to say, even drier than the Brits. I mean, let's talk about the Suez Canal. Allianz said that 10% of global trade goes via this route. This is critically, critically important. And I was just about to say, I was looking at the map earlier, and if you're sort of diverting around the Cape of Good Hope and the southern tip of Africa, surely that's going to add days, if not weeks, to the journey. So if you're a supplier here trying to decide whether you hang on in there and you wait for them to dredge this and hopefully move it, or you start redirecting your supply routes, I mean, these are tough decisions to make, and either way, it's time lost.
Yeah, indeed. So if you're on the southern tip of that canal, you have to say, do I make a U-turn and head for the Cape or not? It does add a week. So those decisions will probably be made over the weekend, whether you cut your losses and move on. And we've been talking about kind of the volume of trade. Some are saying 10%, but it's 30% of seaborne traffic, that's for sure. But what does that mean on a daily basis? Well, we got some information from Lloyd's List saying it's $10 billion with the eastbound and westbound traffic. The westbound traffic is slightly higher. So that is huge scale when you talk about the movement that's taking place right now. And then we said there's dozens of vessels parked. Well, we have an exact number from Lease today, and they're suggesting it's 156. I thought it was interesting, just over 10% of those handle oil, gas, and petrochemicals. Remember, we had that 6% spike in the oil market yesterday, Julia. We're coming down a little bit. Down about 2.5% on Brent, 2.75%, and 3% for WTI. So no panic in the oil market. They think this can be solved as we go forward. It's not going to be that much of a simple equation. And then you have to start thinking about the fallout here of the claims going forward. We know now that the owner of the Ever Given is the Shoei Kinzon of the Ever Given ship right now. Evergreen Marine is the one that chartered it, and they're suggesting that the third-party owner will, of course, have to pay. They say have no claims so far, and the number one priority right now is getting that vessel afloat yet again.
Ben Wedeman joins us now for more. Ben, we keep talking about how this Suez Canal is responsible for 10% of world trade, but what about specifically for Egypt? What about the implications from them of having this waterway blocked?
Well, the Suez Canal, Julia, is a very important source of revenue for the Egyptian government. In 2020, for instance, it earned $5.61 billion from operating the canal. And for ships to stop going through there for days and perhaps weeks is an important loss of revenue, keeping in mind that we're also in the middle of the coronavirus pandemic, which has had an impact on another one of Egypt's important sources of revenue, which is tourism. And of course, then there's simply the prestige of managing for years the Suez Canal and suddenly having to tell a shipping company, sorry, you can't come here. Now, keep in mind, of course, that between June 1967 and 1975, the canal was closed first as a result of the Six-Day War between Israel and Egypt. And it didn't reopen until 1975 after the October War in 1973. So Egypt has gone for long periods in its modern history where the canal wasn't operating. But certainly now, in this day and age, it's an important source of revenue, prestige, and for it suddenly to be blocked, to be closed, is a real blow on many fronts. Julia?
Of course. Many fronts in the region, too, whether we're talking about supplies. I mean, our viewers will recognize that you're in Lebanon as well, ravaged by the challenges of COVID, the explosion that the whole world was watching. Ben, what about the implications for people there, too?
Well, it's a real source of concern, Julia, because Lebanon gets its fuel to generate electricity from the Gulf, and we already have prolonged power outages. Last night, for instance, an unscheduled power outage in my neighborhood from 8 p.m. to 2 a.m. That's in addition to the regular daytime power cuts. If fuel just stops getting to Lebanon completely, a country already deep in crisis will really be on its knees. Syria, for instance, gets a lot of its oil from Iran that goes through the Suez Canal. They also in Syria is suffering from a variety of well-known crises. And if they lose their source of fuel on top of everything else, they also could be facing the abyss. Julia?
Yeah, the whole international community needs to make this a top priority. The importance, the strategic importance of the Suez Canal illustrated once again. Ben, thank you so much for being with us today. Ben Wedeman there.